primary school, and at the time it was Francis Patton. So I got on the bus, and I listened to the bus driver talking to someone outside the window, and was telling him about the assassination, right? And I happened to overhear it, and you know, and he told all the us little children at the time that, yeah, you know, the president got shot in that's what we're at war.
I was working and it came across the radio. We had a radio on at the time. Well, everybody kind of stopped working and they kind of were shocked.
And I was in the cinema and they interrupted the film at one stage to announce that President Kennedy had been assassinated.
I was actually working in a hospital at the time and I was in the filing room and I heard somebody say that he was shot, and of course everybody in the hospital came listening in the radio.
John Fitzgerald Kennedy, known as JFK, was born in Brookline, Massachusetts on May 29, 1917. During World War II, he became a hero for saving his crew after his boat was rammed by a Japanese destroyer in August of 1943. 1 year later, however, his brother Joe Jr. was killed in a flying mission over Europe. When the war ended in 1945, JFK became the vehicle for his father's ambitions. In 1956, JFK was nearly selected as the Democrats' vice presidential candidate. 4 years later, with the end of Eisenhower's second term, John F. Kennedy's time had come. He won the 1960 Democratic nomination and defeated Richard Nixon for the presidency. It was not, however, an easy time. The disaster at the Bay of Pigs and the following Cuban Missile Crisis brought the world to the edge of nuclear war. In December of 1961, John F. Kennedy visited Bermuda for 2 days of talks with British Prime Minister Harold Macmillan. The discussions focused on the question of Berlin and nuclear issues and the situation in the Congo. Throughout his presidency, JFK managed to create a public image immensely attractive to much of America. He was the first television president. With his charm and good looks, he took full advantage of that medium to capture and engage the hearts of Americans. Indeed, the relationship JFK shared with America has often been referred to as a love affair. John F. Kennedy inspired in many a powerful optimism and idealism, and he seemed poised to carry the U.S. out of trying times.
Did you ask him why he invited her?
He said something about not wanting her to have Thanksgiving dinner alone. He didn't think it was right.
It was real nice of the boy.
And I thought about it, and I gave it a great deal of thought, Grandpa.
Here is a bulletin from CBS News. In Dallas, Texas, 3 shots were fired at President Kennedy's motorcade in downtown Dallas. The first reports say that President Kennedy has been seriously wounded by this shooting. More details just arrived. These details about the same as previously. President Kennedy shot today just as his motorcade left downtown Dallas. Mrs. Kennedy jumped up and grabbed Mr. Kennedy. She called, "Oh no," the motorcade sped on. United Press says that the wounds for President Kennedy perhaps could be fatal. Repeating, a bulletin from CBS News, President Kennedy has been shot by a would-be assassin in Dallas, Texas.
Hello, Bermuda, and welcome to this special CITV presentation on the 50th anniversary of the assassination of President John F. Kennedy on November 22, 1963. What is interesting is that the CBS News bulletin you just saw was actually not seen in Bermuda on that day. There was no live television network feed in Bermuda at that time. Bermudians learned through local radio and word of mouth. Joining me on set today are two gentlemen who were on the front lines of broadcasting on that fateful Friday afternoon. Vincent Dyer and Al Seymour were at the fledgling Capital Broadcasting Company, ZFB Radio. Gentlemen, welcome to CITV.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And Mr. Dyer, I'm going to start with you because I'll get to Dad later. But can you tell me what really interested you in getting into radio, and how did it come about?
I was a tinkerer. I used to like to tinker with the electricity, and in fact, I had wired up my sister's dollhouse where we had switches and lights throughout. And that's where the interest started. And further on, I went to a technical school in Toronto and studied electronics. And then from there, for the first year or two, I worked for Bell Services before joining ZFB.
Okay, so you were there from day one at the radio station?
No, I joined I'm just trying to think of the date, 1961, no, 62.
Well, they weren't in 62, so it must
62,
have been
60,
afterwards.
Yes, yeah, okay. Yes.
All right, so, and you came in, and what was your job title there?
I was responsible for the technical support from an engineering point of view, servicing the various equipment and the transmitters. In fact, the transmitter was located in Dockyard.
Dockyard.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, so you were engineer then?
Yes.
Okay, back in the days of vacuum tubes.
Of vacuum tubes and large equipment.
Large equipment.
Yeah.
Okay. And so did you do any voice work or just engineering?
I learned a lot of voice work from Mr. Seymour here.
Okay.
I used to listen in on him. Just going over his notes before he went on air, and certainly I picked up a lot from that. But other than that, I was the man behind the scene.
Must have been an exciting time, then.
It was. It was. Well, you had to make do with what you had,
right.
And you try to get the most out of what you had.
Okay. Well, thanks. I guess in this program I can call you Dad, but I suppose I'll call you Mr. Seymour for once. So tell me, how did you get in radio? Well, we only have a half an hour, so.
Oh, exactly. You told me that.
Yeah.
Well, actually, I was interested in radio in the early, late 40s, I believe, and just loved radio and voices that I heard. There used to be a gentleman once on the local radio station I had here. They only had but one, I think, at that point. Johnny Nisbet's Passing Parade. I used to listen to him every night because he brilliantly spoke fluently and a high pace, and I was captivated by that, and it never left me. And so over the years, I just listened to other programs that were being broadcast that we can only pick up at night here. And CBS was one of the big stations that I got attached to, with a little tiny radio that had tubes in those days, if you remember, Vince. And so my interest kept going from that point on, and it just never left me. And I sort of dreamed about actually getting into radio, being an announcer, and never thought it would really happen, but dreamed about it because I admired the many announcers I used to hear. And I just kept practicing on my own, and because I just felt that if you practiced enough, eventually something would rub in and stick with you. And so, fortunately, Montague Shepherd, who owned the station, one day he just came into a school where I was teaching. I used to teach art briefly for a couple of years. And he had heard that I sort of was interested and loved broadcasting. So he just told me point blank, he said, I'm starting a radio station, and I'd like to have you as part of it. And the rest is history.
The rest is history. Okay, that fateful Friday. A fateful day in history globally, as we all know. Can you tell me how that day and that moment was for you, Mr. Dyer? I mean, it must have been quite a time.
It certainly was unbelievable. I was at home. I hadn't turned in for work yet. And couldn't believe it. But once I heard the news, I was pretty sure that we would be doing something at the radio station to cover this. We were one of the foremost go-getters. We certainly beat out the other radio station many times because of these just heads
and
up yes.
Innovation.
Yes.
Okay. So I guess you dropped tools and came straight to the station and began to get things ready.
It certainly had to settle in because it was difficult to believe that this happened.
Yeah.
But once it did settle in, yes, I came on to work.
Okay. And how did you find out about it, and what was your initial reaction to it? Because we have something special, and I just want to find out.
I had been at the station all day, but, you know, it's amazing. When that happened, as Vince just mentioned, I was had just reached home after a full day at the station, and the secretary called and asked if I could come back to the station immediately because they had shot the president. Well, you know, you're hearing something like that for the first time, you're going into a twirl. And I asked the question, president of what? You know, when they said President Kennedy, dropped everything and headed back to the station. We forgot about what time it was. Mm-hmm. We forgot about eating and anything like that. Ira Phillip, who was the main writer at that time, began to compose, get things together. We knew we had to get a lot of reaction, and the wheel started turning. Vince did an incredible job of taking inserts that we picked up on little tiny recorders that we had at that time in the street, and he put them on reel-to-reels and the studio. But he had to do this with putting each insert in a little section and marking it with a piece of paper. I don't know how he did that.
Okay. Yeah. Sounds interesting. And what we're going to do now is do something special for, I guess, the station, you two gentlemen, and Bermuda. For the first time in 50 years, CITV will present to you a special recording of the radio broadcast on Saturday, November 23rd, 1963, the morning after the assassination. We have attempted to clean up the audio as much as possible from the original analog tape recording.
Newsroom in the wires of the Associated Press and the facilities of the Voice of America, we present a special newscast on the assassination of President Kennedy. First, here are the headlines. The world mourns the death of President John F. Kennedy, and the man is charged with the president's murder. Those are the headlines. Now the story. The whole world by now is aware and mourns the tragic assassination of the President of the United States, John F. Kennedy. Lyndon Johnson was sworn in as the nation's 36th president and immediately went to Washington. Early this morning, it was announced that a man, Lee Harvey Oswald, was officially charged with the murder of President Kennedy. Oswald was dragged screaming from a theater by police after he had killed a police officer who was attempting to hold him on suspicion in connection with the assassination of Kennedy. Minutes after he had been shot down, stations at FC broadcast the news. Some 35 minutes after the shooting, the Voice of America issued this report.
President Kennedy is dead. The President of the United States was shot down by an assassin's bullet. He rode through downtown Dallas, Texas, in an open automobile today. The gunfire also cut down Texas Governor John Conley, who was riding with the president. The governor remains seriously wounded, and according to reports, is now in the operating room. President Kennedy was rushed to Parkland Hospital in Dallas, his head bloody. Their efforts to save his life fail, and John Fitzgerald Kennedy, in his third year in office, died today from an assassin's bullet.
Here in Bermuda, news of the tragedy stunned just about everyone beyond words. Representing his excellency the governor, the Honorable J.W. Sykes reads a copy of the telegram which was sent to Washington.
Her Excellency following them to the British ambassador in Washington. message begins. The whole of Bermuda has been shocked this afternoon to hear of the tragic death of President Kennedy. On behalf of the government and people of this colony, I hasten to offer our deepest and sincere sympathy to Mrs. Kennedy and her children and to all the people of the United States. Message ends. I might add that I've also just been speaking to the governor on the telephone in Washington, and he tells me that only the day before yesterday he was speaking to President Kennedy and had a meeting with him, and he, of course, is terribly shocked at the news.
Sir Alan Smith, the acting Chief Justice, made this comment on the death of President Kennedy.
Tragedy at all times, when a brave, able, and forceful leader of a great nation is suddenly killed in his prime. And the effects of this loss will doubtless be felt not only throughout his own country, but throughout the world. But what grieves me most are the circumstances of his passing, shot when sitting opposite to his wife in the car. My first thoughts are of her and his family. May God in his good time heal the wounds in their hearts, give them the courage and patience to bear the ordeal they are suffering.
Also commenting on the tragedy was the American Consul General, Mr. George Renshard.
The announcement of the assassination of the President of the United States has come to me as a great and tragic shock. My wife and I have sent a personal message of sympathy to Mrs. Kennedy.
Mr. Arnold Francis, MCP, leader of the Progressive Labor Party, had this to say on the tragedy.
The astounding news of President Kennedy's assassination while on my feet in the Supreme Court this afternoon. I can only say that I was shocked by the news. I think that the people of the United States, and indeed the world, have lost a great and talented leader. I'm convinced that the Negroes of the United States and the world have lost a stalwart supporter of their cause. The young and potential leaders of America, I believe, regarded President Kennedy as an idol and an example. I feel his death is a shocking blow to them and their aspirations. We all feel great sympathy for Mrs. Kennedy and her two young children in this hour of their grief.
Senate D1 took its microphone in the street. Here are some comments from people from all walks of life.
It was a very great shock to everybody.
A very great shock to us all, and we're very sorry about it.
Right now, since you've asked me what do I feel in regards to President Kennedy's assassination, I feel that it's a great blow to Bermuda and all of the world. And because that Bermuda has been associated with America for quite a number of years, and the importance and nearness of America that has meant so much to Bermuda is a great blow to the entire world and Bermuda.
Well, Percy, I just happened to be out making the usual rounds this afternoon when I heard this news, and believe you me, when I heard it, I couldn't believe my ears because of, who the person is, of course. And President Kennedy is a man that is held in high esteem, I'm sure, by almost everyone. And for something to happen like this, it's almost unbelievable.
Well, I guess you could say we're shocked, and it is a great loss to America, to the whole world. I think it's a personal loss to the whole world, besides Americans. And it's something that's hard to believe has actually happened. It's just like you feel a death in your own family.
I can say, Mr. Payne, this is a terrible thing to have happened at this time.
I just didn't know what to think about it. The lady stopped us on the street, told us, and we didn't believe it. A few other people told us, and we called down to our submarine and got the word from them that the president had been shot, and it shocked us all.
I think it was pretty tragic. I think it's an entire shock to the whole free world. I don't know what the change of events will take place now with Lyndon Johnson in there and the forthcoming election.
I was very shocked to hear President Kennedy's assassination, and very sad. And I certainly hope that the assassins will be brought to justice as quickly as possible.
That was what I consider to be an amazing piece of video, actually. Looking at it and dating it back to 1963, 50 years the tape has survived. And we hope that you were able to sort of absorb some of the, I guess, atmosphere of the seriousness of that time. And back to our two gentlemen in studio, I'm going to talk to Mr. Dyer and ask you, how was the next 48 hours for you at ZFB? Was it very hectic? I mean, we compare it to today with satellite and internet and everything. How was it for you and the staff back then?
It certainly was hectic. What we were getting in is these recordings from the folks in the field, or the various interviews from the different people, and that had to be more or less stitched or spliced together.
Okay, for our viewers, splice means to physically cut the audio tape.
That's true. To cut it and to cut it right down to
the letter, as we say
exactly.
Sometimes. Frame.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
Right.
And then back it up or put it together with to the next segment.
Right.
So
did you use
speak.
Like a tape or it was like
we would listen to it a number of times,
right,
and more or less pinpoint it as to where this sentence finished, and a little marker we'd mark it, and okay. Then with a splicing machine, which is a metal piece of equipment, yeah, similar to a miter box, if you wish,
right, just
and take the cut and bring in and join it up, and listen again to see if there were no hiccups in there as such.
Must have been a rush, I mean, in terms of time, trying to make a deadline for air.
Most definite. And we worked quite well together, and we'd listen to it and either add or take out certain bits of it.
Okay.
And yes, it was over the next, as you said, the next 48 hours or longer, we were not only doing this presentation, but mm-hmm. also bringing in the various news stories from the BBC, mm-hmm. Voice of America, and that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. That,
in terms of engineering and things of that nature, that were you guys ever contacted by any foreign news agency or anything for a Bermuda take on the incident? Do you remember anything of that nature?
Not to my knowledge.
Okay.
No.
In terms of the funeral of JFK, did ZFB cover it via shortwave, or how did you manage to deal with that?
I'm not certain of the details, but certainly we would have covered it by shortwave, Voice of America,
right.
More than likely.
Right.
That,
okay.
And of course, that would have to been. We would either play it directly as we received it, or record it for later newscast.
Okay, great. And for you, how was it? I'd say because life, I guess in some ways, life has to go on. So how was the following 48 hours for you? I mean, right up to, say, maybe the funeral, like?
Well, first of all, we were a very young station, and we were learning in the process. So we knew this was a mammoth incident and a mammoth task. And as Vince was describing just now, the inserts, what he didn't tell you was that the script put together, I think by Ira Phillip, who was the main writer, had the points where he would have to send those inserts through, so he had to listen very carefully. And the other thing is that it didn't dawn on us till later, the full impact of the tragedy, because we were so busy trying to get the story on the air to serve our listeners that we were worrying about the technical side. We were concerned. We felt the impact of it all. But when you're so busy in it, it's not until you sort of step back and you realize what really has happened. And for instance, it's almost blank to, I guess, I don't know, but Vince, what happened during the day prior to this. And the next day, since that was such a main story, because our main newscast was just on that, and it stayed that way for, I think, for a couple of days. We didn't have cable. We didn't have all of those other internet, nothing like that. So we had and we still had local stories to cover.
Did you have a wire service, like what they call the thumper machine?
Like an AP machine? I think we did. There was a point where we used to get it from another source, copies of the tape, and then eventually I think we had a machine put in there that used to help us in keeping abreast of developing incidents around the world. And the important thing was that we wanted the station to keep functioning, healthy, and as Vince said, we worked together very closely, and that was the only way we could have put it together. And when the dust settled, and you mentioned about covering the funeral, I can't remember details about it, but I do know that the shortwave system would have served that.
Who was the gentleman, Percy?
I'm glad you mentioned that.
Yes.
Because as soon as we heard the bulletin, what had happened, the whole team that we had in the station, we didn't have a large team. Mm-hmm. Percy Painter, who was a very distinguished personality in the entertainment world, who joined us. Mm-hmm. He was a wonderful jazz enthusiast, and he didn't ask any questions. When we said, we need you to get some feedback from the outside community, mm-hmm. he said, fine, got his tape, and he went. So that's why you heard occasionally them saying, Percy.
That's his only interview. Yeah. Well, we don't have much time, gentlemen, but of course, the assassination of John F. Kennedy, every generation has its moments, the space shuttle and, the 9/11, President Obama being elected. But real quick, it's an interesting, do you think we'll ever know what really, really happened
that day? Well, as a journalist, we sort of live by what we know or what we find out as facts.
Right.
And until we find something different, that's what we go with. And before, I know you said we didn't have much time left, but I must say that you are very significant in this as well, because you were just a baby when this happened, and here you are the one hosting this program. And that is incredible.
People just tuned up. Well, thank you very much for joining us on CITV today, taking time. It's a bit of history happening again. Thanks, Dad, for coming on.
Very good.
And thank you, the viewers watching out there on CITV. And thank you, Bermuda, for watching this special on the 50th anniversary of the assassination of President John F. Kennedy. Thanks for joining us. I'm Al Seymour.